Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to an awesome episode of ADVMoto Live. We've got ADVMoto Live number 31 today. After 10 years of making off-road routes around much of the United States, year number 11 takes us to the great state of Wyoming. What's riding like? How does it stand up to the previous expeditions? And what should you know before you go? We'll also try to field some audience questions, so if anyone's in the chat room, feel free to ask away, and we will cover what we can. All this on tonight's ADVMoto Live number 31, Wyoming BDR, ready to roll. All right, you know, not too long ago, the idea of adventure riding really wasn't as popular or ubiquitous as today, at least in the motorcycle industry. A lot has happened since then, and the BDR organization has been a key player in propagating not only the very important message of responsible riding, but making and sharing tracks through some of the most beautiful parts in the U.S. While showing us all the natural beauty of America, these routes, and this is very important, and sometimes not discussed, but these routes also help bring economic awareness and improvement to many towns that normally get passed by on the interstates. So here to share their experiences on the latest Wyoming installment, everyone, please welcome Tim James, Wendy Naessens, and Sterling Noren. Yay! How's it going, guys? Mad applaud track. I want to crank the applaud track up to 11. Awesome, guys. How are you doing today? Oh, awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, tell you what, we're going to start out with our usual stuff. Could each of you kind of introduce, you know, who you are, what you do, and what your background is with motorcycling?
So my name is Tim James, and I've been riding motorcycles pretty much my whole life. Dirt bikes as a kid, turned 18, got my first street bike and never looked back, and got back into dirt riding probably after I got into the workforce and adventure riding probably about 15 years ago, I'd say. So my day job is I have an advertising agency, but my part-time job is volunteering with BDR, and I help out with a lot of the marketing and promotion of and route development and whatever needs to be done, which is often a lot. I serve on the board of directors for the BDR.
Awesome. Yeah. So for those of you who may not know, a lot of the stuff that you see that comes from the BDR, like the images and stuff, for those of you that are ADVMoto subscribers and you get the print edition, you know, we've had these little mini pull-out maps and stuff. All those come from Tim's agency, and it's a lot of work that he does, and it's worth some accolades because it is a ton of time and work, and it's passion driven. Yeah. All right, awesome. Sterling?
Yeah, hey, my name is Sterling Noren, and I'm one of the founders of Backcountry Discovery Routes in 2010. I started motorcycling as a kid, and I got into adventure riding in 1998. That was my first ADV bike, and that was also the year I made my first ADV moto film. And I spent about 12 years making films with globe riders, traveling around the world, documenting motorcycle trips in other countries. And none of those rides were adventure riding as we know it. It was more street touring, but in a different developing countries, so very adventurous. So that was kind of my background before 2010, when the opportunity came up to start Backcountry Discovery Routes. I've been involved with that organization since that time. I was a board member for a while, but always a filmmaker first and foremost. And this is route number 11. I've produced 9 of the BDR films to this date and continue to do that. Love working with Backcountry Discovery Routes. And I think nowadays probably most people know me from my YouTube channel, the Motorcycle Travel Channel.
Oh yeah. And I think we have a link to his channel. If you haven't seen it, definitely check it out. He's got a lot of great stuff in there. And I think there's a link to that in the show description. Well, that's cool, man. That's cool, man. So let's get straight to the topic, which is the Wyoming BDR. I know a lot of people are anxious about it. Like whenever you guys release, these routes, there's a lot of anticipation. both for the routes, but also for this awesome film that's going to be coming up. And we're going to give away a couple of tickets at the end of the show for those that hang in there and stick in there. So organizationally, maybe this might go best to Tim, I'm not sure, but you know, how did the Wyoming BDR come to be? You know, why Wyoming? There's so many beautiful states. Mm-hmm. And, you know, were there any key players in getting the route together?
Yeah, for sure. Bryce Stevens, who is another co-founder of the organization, was really the driving force with the Wyoming route. And he's actually been working on it for about 4 years. So it's been in development for quite some time. And kind of COVID came about. It was actually going to be released last year, but unfortunately we didn't have a route last year. But why Wyoming? It's just an unbelievable state. It's got more opportunities for adventure riding than probably any state we've done so far. And it's just so wide open and just tons of dirt roads and mountain ranges. And it's a perfect state for a BDR and the lowest population of, I think, of all the states in the country. It might be the lowest. Don't quote me on that, but it's pretty darn low.
Yeah, I mean, I've been through Wyoming a couple of times on bike. It is pretty low. How about versus Montana? I mean, Montana is another amazingly beautiful state. I've heard that also does not have a very dense population, at least in the
I think that they have some bigger cities, though. I think that that's probably the case. Well, they probably beat them out in population. But it is a great spot for a BDR, and it really, really worked out well. Bryce put a lot of time and effort into it, and there was a whole team of people. It wasn't just Bryce, but he kind of led the development and really delivered.
Wow. Now, some people might not know this, but, you know, the crew that you see on the videos, right, or on the films, it is not absolutely everybody that went into making that happen. About how many people do you think it takes to put together a route? Because there's prep work before you guys even do it. Then you guys scout it, then you guys film it, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think it varies per route. It's if I had to put a number to it, I would have to guess the actual scouting on this one's probably at least, you know, 8 or 10 people. But it's different for every route, you know, there was a good team, and a lot of people had some input on this, but you need a leader, right? So you need somebody to aggregate all that information and organize it and make the choices, right? And Bryce is just so talented at that.
Right on. All right. So the basics, okay. What makes the Wyoming BDR different than the other routes? And, you know, the question that a lot of people ask on every single one of these is, you know, is it too challenging? Can I do it as a new rider? Do I have to be an advanced rider or what? And I think we can pull all three of you on this one.
Well, we should throw to Sterling on this one because of the people on the phone, he's ridden the route more than anyone. He's ridden a couple of times because he pre-wrote it. Why don't we let him take a stab at that one first, right?
Sure.
Yeah. So the way it works is, once the track is finalized and done, they give it to me so that I can ride it in order to scout it, make some waypoints, look at some good places for filming. And so, first of all, that's just a huge honor and a privilege to be able to do that. I can't tell you how excited it is to get a new BDR track before everyone else and know that I'm the first one out there riding it and seeing it in its entirety from beginning to end. So I did that this summer. And right before I did the Wyoming trip, I was out riding in Colorado for a week by myself, sort of getting warmed up. And then I rolled into Wyoming and spent 6 days riding this route, seeing it for the very first time. I was with another person, our drone pilot, Cam, joined me on the scouting trip because it's always a good idea to have another person with you on a BDR and not do it solo. So he joined me for the first 4 days, and then I finished up the last couple of days by myself. And I had an absolutely incredible time doing it. What I love about Wyoming is that it's so remote. And the reason I say that is because, you know, last year I did a 6,000 mile ride across the Western US for my YouTube channel. And the part of that ride that I enjoyed the most was Wyoming, because of its vastness, its openness, it's, you know, less people. And that's just what I like. I personally really like to get out there in those remote environments. And I think that's what really makes Wyoming special for me is that there's just a lot of remote country out there.
Awesome. Now, how about, you know, I mean, yeah, from the experience standpoint, that is phenomenal, right? But like, some people then on the flip side of that might worry about, well, how about, you know, like facilities, gas stations, and all that kinds of stuff.
Yeah, well that's where we come in, because that's what we do for the community, right? We go and develop these routes and put all that information together for you. So between the map and the resources that are on the website, you can equip yourself with all the knowledge that you need to go out and tackle one of these BDRs.
So it's not a problem. Like, it's not so remote that, for example, like in Idaho, where the roads follow like a lot of the rivers, if you take the wrong road and some of them aren't marked and you run out of gas, you know, you're not going to be anywhere near where you thought you were, you know, like.
If you're talking Wyoming in comparison to the other ones, you could get yourself in trouble in Wyoming, because there's a good amount of distance between gas stops. It could definitely be challenging. You don't want to get, you know, stuck out in the middle of a section with no gas or, engine failure. You need to be equipped with some ways of getting in touch, you know, a satellite phone, a spot tracker or something like that. We really encourage that.
That's cool. What kind of range do you think you would need?
I think that the longest range on this is probably 160 miles, 150, maybe 150 miles might be the longest. I'd have to check on that. But that's probably about right.
Right on. And Wendy, what were your thoughts on this in terms of difficulty, you know, for new or advanced riders? Now, as a trainer, you know, I'm sure you have much higher than average skills, but, you know, what are your thoughts on that?
I would say there were a lot of sections that were very technical, but you could get through them. If you have any training at all, you would be able to do, you know, 95% of the entire BDR. Now, the hero sections, that's another story, right? The advanced sections. But as far as, you know, there wasn't any moment that I felt like I couldn't get through the section.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Now, of course, we have to have a question, kind of ranking this. This comes from Life's Journey at 50. Where would Wyoming rank among the BDRs? It's got to be a hard question to answer because they're so different. But if you had to stick them on a scale of 1 to 11, or this is, you know what I mean? Like, what would you guys say?
What do you mean by rank? Are you talking difficulty or enjoyment, or there's different ways to look at that?
It's number one in my heart.
Number one in my heart. There you go. There you go. Good answer. however you would like to say then, Sterling.
Well, people always ask me, like, what's the favorite country you've been to, or what's the best BDR? And I always say it's the one that I'm on. You know, that's my favorite one, the one that I'm currently experiencing. Even if I was riding one of the old ones, if I'm on it, it's going to be the best one. Wyoming was great. Again, it's very remote. As far as the difficulty level for me, when I rode it on the scouting trip, I didn't take any of the expert sections because I was, again, kind of by myself or just with Cam. So sticking to the main route, I didn't have any problems whatsoever. I thought it was easy. So maybe harder than Idaho, definitely harder than Idaho, but like easy to mid level on the BDRs as far as technical goes. Of course, if you do the expert sections, they're expert sections for a reason, and those are going to be challenging, and they were challenging. So that's kind of my take on the difficulty level of it.
Awesome. Now, Tim, what do you think?
I'd probably concur with Sterling. I think it's right, probably average difficulty if you're riding the main route. It probably has more off highway than most. I would say that the percentage of tarmac to off highway is, I bet you we're close to, but we're over 80% of dirt roads on this route. Where some were down to, you know, 60. It depends on the states, right? Like the Northeast, it's really hard to weave together, you know, 80% dirt through 1,300 miles. But this one is mostly dirt. So that's huge, because that's what our community wants, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, some of the footage from the teaser, I mean, it looks like the place to go. You know what I mean? Yeah. I myself don't mind some technical stuff, but probably like many riders out there, you know, I just want to be in some beautiful landscapes, see some interesting towns and people, you know, and I want some off-road challenge, but I don't want to necessarily kill myself or break a bone doing it. Got a home to get back to with kids and everything. You know what I mean?
Right. Right. And yeah, you know what, Carl, we developed the routes to pretty much be that, right? We don't want people out there getting hurt. So the main routes are supposed to be, doable for an average rider with a fully loaded adventure bike. That's kind of the bar that we set. And then of course we put in some really challenging sections for the people who want a little more, right? And those sections often are short. They're not really long. You know, maybe they're 4 to 8 miles. You know, people go in to give it a shot. If it's too much, they can turn around and come back and hit the main route again.
Right on. Now, as far as seasonality, because that's also really important. I mean, Sterling, if you've been out there on a couple different rides, right? Like you've ridden it like a couple times.
Yeah.
Did you get to experience any kind of, you know, like weather differentials? And you know what I mean? Like it was just pissing rain one time and the next time it was beautiful and no dust or
what? You know, when I scouted the trip, it only rained just a little bit on us, but it had rained previously the day before in some sections. So there was some mud in the road, and there were 3 or 4 times where I tipped over. And I tipped over on the scouting trip bad enough that I actually bent my handlebars and had to finish that whole ride with bent handlebars just because of the mud. So, you know, weather, as with all BDRs, can really change things. But in general, we had pretty good weather for the scouting trip. But when I was returning back to the beginning of the route after the scouting trip, I was going down the highway and this freak hailstorm came out of nowhere. And I just happened to be on a spot of the highway where I was 50 miles from any turnoff with services or gas in any direction. And I literally was riding 5 miles an hour down the road with hail coming down and trucks pulled over on the side of the road. Eventually I pulled over and a guy in a van stopped and asked me if I wanted to take shelter inside of his van. And I said, no, I'm cool. I'm okay. And so he took off down the highway and I got buttoned back up and I ended up passing him going down the highway. The hill was coming down. But in the movie, there's actually a shot of that when Bryce is talking about the weather and what can happen. I included some helmet camera footage of that hailstorm when I was going down the highway.
Oh, that's awesome. So what time of year would be best to go, do you reckon?
So this route is probably going to have a shorter window than most, because there's a lot of elevation changes. And so it's probably going to be a May to September route, before, you know, the snow starts setting in and on the early side when it's not, you know, too muddy or wet. And it's worth mentioning that like a lot of the states out west, there's that surface, that clay surface, that if it gets wet, it's completely unrideable. So that's something that riders are going to have to keep in mind when, you know, as they're going through this BDR. If there's really stormy weather, they have to think about where, you know, what they're going to do, because you might have to just go around or wait it out a day, because you can really get yourself banged up.
Now, some of those areas look fairly flat. How's the drainage? You know, like if it rains, does it just pool up everywhere into giant puddles of mud, or is there any?
We got so lucky, we don't know.
Right on.
Well, you do see the residual from that, right? So you see a lot of ruts, and that's where, yeah, you know, you'll see from the so there's a lot of ruts in Wyoming. But we did get, Wendy is absolutely right, we got so lucky on the filming expedition. We didn't see one drop of rain until the final day when we were actually had finished the route and we were heading up to Montana. It was super lucky.
Well, that's great for the cameraman.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about your equipment and, you know, although I guess sometimes it might make for some dramatic footage if you don't mind dealing with the weather. And I'm sure you've dealt with that a bunch. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Sterling, you filmed so many of these trips, you know, cinematically for you. How does the Wyoming route compare, you know, from the video photographic standpoint? And are there any places that, you know, that stand out in your mind that someone, you know, should go there and capture?
Well, they just keep getting better and better because we get better cameras. We've got drone pilots now. We've got two or three cameramen, multiple GoPros for, so, you know, regardless of what Wyoming has to offer, we just can see it more cinematically now through the film because we're better at doing that. But, you know, Wyoming itself, I mean, every state in the West is gorgeous, and Wyoming is no exception. Yes, there are more vast open areas, but that said, we had some really incredible mountain peaks and some vistas, some high points with like lookout towers that we were able to go up to, mountain summits. You're going to see some really cool colored rock formations, like red and brown, different colors of rocks. Then there's going to be, you know, green grasses with just a path going across the grassland. So, you know, a variety of scenic, beautiful locations along this route. I would say some of the highlights would be some of the mountain peaks in the beginning. I forget the name of the mountain range that we went through.
We have the Snowy Mountains that are probably
Snowy Mountains. Yeah, exactly. Yep. Snowy Mountains were a highlight. The riding along the Beaver Rim is absolutely a highlight. That's something I had never heard of before, but you're riding on the edge of this sort of like a Grand Canyon. I mean, it's not as big or vast, but you still get that feeling, and you're right on the edge for like 50 miles, you know, right? So absolutely fantastic. And then Kennedy Peak with a real high forest lookout up on the top there. So yeah, a lot of fun, cool, beautiful spots on this route.
Very cool. Are there any areas that you think, you know, would be dangerous or anything like that? You know what I mean? Like,
well, there's that one
turns into a goat trail or something.
There's a water crossing that we go through that if it has rained a lot or something like that, then it may be uncrossable.
Yeah. And that kind of plays into what we were talking about before, like going too early in the season. That crossing may not, it may be just too deep. It could be 6 feet deep. Something else to think about when you're planning your trip, right?
And we should point out that water crossing is on an expert section, so there's a clear workaround for that.
Oh, great. That's cool. That's cool. Don't the new GSs come with 7-foot snorkels?
The snorkels.
Wasn't that one of the
It's an option. I'm sure it's an option. Yeah.
Doubles as a periscope, and you see it on your TFT like a submarine.
That'd be amazing.
That would be sick. That would be sick. I'm sure it's in the works somewhere for them, you know. But all right, so... are there any special or favorite sections of the route? This sort of goes back, but I'm just saying about, you know, like from, maybe not so much from the visual experience, but from like the rider's experience, you know what I mean? Like any parts where you were just kind of hit with, you know, the spine tinglies, like, oh man, this was, you know what I mean? Like sometimes you ride through some places and you feel, I don't want to say holy, but it's just kind of like, you know what I mean? Like there's a, almost like a religious connection between you and the place.
Yeah.
I think on the scouting trip and also when we filmed the movie, the section leading into Ten Sleep before you get into the town of Ten Sleep, which by the way, is a really cool small town. There's a brewery that we stayed at. You can camp at the brewery. So how cool is that? But the ride into Ten Sleep through the Norwood Gorge and just it's like a country road that goes on for like 100 miles, beautiful red canyons and rocks. And we did it at sunset when we were on the scouting trip. And it was really, truly one of them. It was like what I live for when I'm riding on these kind of trips. It was not technically challenging at all. Just a beautiful country road that just wound for miles and miles through the landscape. And I mean, talk about feeling holy. That's when I felt the holiest on that trip.
Right on, man. That sounds beautiful. Wendy, what do you think?
I don't know. My favorite sections, one of my most favorite sections, Jocelyn and I split off from the group for one part of it, and we ended up meeting up with them on the trail. And so we had to turn around and go back and do this section in particular again. Do you guys remember the name of that part of the track?
Shirley Mountains, yeah.
Oh my gosh, the Shirley Mountains. That was like one of my most favorite. I think for me, the moments that were the most memorable were when I felt like I was stuck or I was getting into something hairy and then I made it to the other side just fine. That to me is like, I love that challenge and getting to the other side. So those were always the best moments for me.
Yeah, that's where the growth is.
Yeah. Right?
Like the confidence and really just the belief in yourself and also the machines mm-hmm. and your friends mm-hmm. and everything. Yeah, that is straight up awesome. Tim? Mm-hmm.
I'd have to say that the Shirley Mountains are pretty spectacular because there's really diverse terrain over it. There's a rocky ascent that's steep in places and with some switchbacks and then there's sand and ledges and
giant loose ruts. Stuff.
I mean, ruts. You yeah. name it. It kind of throws everything at you and to Wendy's point, it just makes you feel like you've accomplished something when you make it through a section like that. But that's just before, the Beaver Rim, it's leading to that's the day we also did the Beaver Rim. So it wound up, you'll see when you watch the film, it wound up being a really long day, almost 14 hours of riding. And you asked about that visceral experience, right? For me, it was, that day that we rode the entire length of the Beaver Rim and got into Atlantic City, which is where we stayed that night. And it was just an epic ride. And we got in at sunset. So the sun was just, hiding over the mountains and it was getting dark. And it was really, really a wonderful experience. And I'll probably never forget that day.
Awesome. Awesome. So we got a couple. Sorry, go ahead.
That was a 260-mile day, too.
Yeah.
Wow, 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 awesome. Yeah. That's a whopper.
It's a long day when some may say that's not a long day. I've done 260 miles on an adventure ride, but we were filming. Yeah. So it's not like you're riding the entire time. So
stop, turn around, stop, turn around.
Go
stop,
do that. Go do that again. Yeah, exactly. So yeah. It is. That's about as many miles I think that we'd probably want to do on a filming day, right, Sterling?
On a work production
day.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. And, so there. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. No, I was just gonna say when we all got back to camp at the end of the day, or I guess the inn that we stayed at. Monty had made, he was our support driver, made the best giant cheeseburgers. And that was like, to me, the best meal we had on the trip after that long day.
Sometimes it's the best meal you've had in your life.
Yeah.
Like when you're eating it, you're like, oh man, this is the best we've ever had in my life.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, there was a couple questions from the audience here. Let me check this out. So one, which I think Sterling addressed in the chat, but we'll talk about it here real quick, is how many days to complete the route on average? And the other one is, are there dealer or service centers along the route? From Chris Clardy.
Chris Clardy? Hey, Chris.
Yeah, Chris, there's not. There's really nothing. It's funny. We had the support of BMW Motorrad USA on this. They were one of our lead supporters on this film, and we're kind of hoping to stop into a BMW dealer along the way. There's just no BMW dealer. I don't think there's one in Wyoming. There's not a lot of services like that. There's a lot of locals that will be willing to help you. People are super friendly, but you got to prepare for that.
Right on. And how many days?
It's 8 sections. And roughly we always kind of suggest a section a day. So, let's just say it's a week adventure. Let's call it a week. Budget a week.
Okay. Right on. Okay. So you guys have run this through. Are there any particular things anyone should do to prepare for the Wyoming BDR physically, mentally, or equipment-wise?
They should come to the Performance Center and take the 2-day off-road course because everything on this Wyoming BDR you're going to see at the Performance Center, and we can prepare you for that. I think my biggest takeaway from, post-trip is have extra water. Have The hydro packs that you can just swap out, just have extra ones filled and ready to go. That was super convenient. Extra gas, and then also hydration tablets. Very important. You do not realize how quickly you can become dehydrated. So,
how much water did you guys carry with you per person?
I carried roughly.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I had just over 6 liters, and I would always refill one or two of the 2 liter bags that I carried at lunchtime. So,
okay.
About a gallon a day.
About a gallon a day?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, how much of that was, so of the trip, because you said it's quite remote, the other question too, which I guess we'll figure out later once we see the film and have access to the maps and stuff, but, you know, camping versus hotels and, you know, places to tank up, not just your bike, but your water bags.
Yeah. I would say that one thing you do have to be careful on this route is to be aware of what the next section is, if there's gas or if there's food along the way, because you need to make sure that you have the food and water you need so that you don't ride all day and then the sun is going down and you kind of have to find a place to camp and you don't have any supplies. That actually happened to me on the scouting trip. I didn't realize that I needed to buy my food and water and everything for that night's camp before I left in the morning. There was nothing along the way on that particular day.
Yeah. So you should always have some supplies on your bike.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think even if your plan is to hotel it the whole way, which you could do, you want to have something on your bike so that if you do get caught out there overnight, you know, one of those, you know, small like thermal pack sleeping bags and some, you know, freeze dried food, something at least small pack that you could make it through an evening if you had to, like, you know, hunker down and call it a night, you know.
Yeah, right on. Okay. Anything else gear wise in terms of maybe, you know, like the bike or anything in terms of,
yep,
you know, like mentally or anything like that?
Well, when we talk about the bike, let's start there and then maybe someone else can take the mental one.
Sure.
So definitely tubes. If you're running a tubeless tire, bring tubes because you're going to get flats. We probably had in our team, we probably had at least 4 flats. Am I right? At least 4 over the course of the week.
Rocks or?
It could be pinch flats. It could be, ruts, you know, it could be anything. Yeah. I would say mostly pinch flats, hitting hard embedded rocks. We had some sidewall slashes. So it's absolutely make sure you have tubes, pump, everything you need to, and then your basic tools. You really, you gotta, sometimes things break. And so, the duct tape, baling wire, that kind of thing. You always want to have that kind of stuff on hand to put things back together, at least temporarily.
The old standards.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right.
For sure.
That's right.
But anyone want to take that question on about the getting mentally prepared for one of these rides?
I mean, we keep talking about it, but it is very isolated. So if you're taking the trip and you're bringing a friend, make sure you like them.
Right on. Good stuff. Yeah. All right. Question from the audience. 2 of them, actually. One from Frank Kogler. How's the cell phone coverage? And another one from William Eakins. Is this one designed to run south to north?
So
is there like a direction that you intend
yeah,
to be?
Is that Billy? Or? That's Bill Eakins. I know him. That's the way we run them in the expedition, you know, on the expeditions and the way that they're designed, but all the routes can be ridden in either direction. There might be sections that would be tougher to ride in the opposite directions. And that goes across all of our routes, but it can be ridden in either direction.
Okay. Now how about cell coverage?
There isn't any. Yeah.
True adventure.
Yeah.
So satellite phone or bust, right?
A minimum a spot tracker or some kind of satellite messenger. We always have a couple of satellite phones in the group when we're doing an expedition because we always use them at some point. So
sure. Now this is a question. You don't hear this discussed very much, but maybe you can shed some light on this from personal experience. And that is, who do you guys use for satellite phones? You know, I mean, who would you recommend?
Well, I mean, I don't know if we want to endorse anyone, because I don't, I can't even remember the brand of mine, to be honest with you, putting me on the spot.
Well, it's probably more about the service providers, to be honest. Yeah.
I mean, I think there's only a handful. I'm trying to think. That's a great question. I can't remember. I've had mine for so many years, I can't recall the service. But gosh, Sterling, do you have one?
No, don't.
What do you use, Sterling? Oh,
it's Iridium. I'm sorry. Iridium is the name of the Iridium. Just senior moment here. And it's that I've had a lot of luck with that company.
That's good.
So,
do you just use like a messaging service, Sterling? Like a spot tracker or something like that, or what?
Well,
the above?
I'm kind of old school. I don't have a sat phone or a spot tracker or an inReach or any of that stuff. When I go out, it's just going to be me on a mountain.
Right on, man. Very cool. Very cool.
I'm not endorsing that. I'm telling you the truth, but you know, it's probably something I should get an inReach at some point, given the amount of time I spend in the backcountry. You know, that's really the sensible answer.
Right on. And Bill Cagnacci says, is the Colorado BDR able to be linked to the Wyoming?
So, I mean, all of our routes, I mean, they don't run directly into each other.
They don't run right into each other.
And we'll often do a connector route that's included, a downloadable file. We don't have one yet, but I'm sure we'll probably do one at some point.
Okay. Right on. And then, let's see here. One last one for this section here. Wildlife. What kind of wildlife can you see out there?
Yeah, lots of wildlife. We saw plenty of antelope. That's probably the number one.
Tons. Mm-hmm.
Wild horses.
Lots of deer. Yeah. The wild horses were beautiful. Giant moose. One of the inns that we stayed at, there was this giant male moose munching on a bush right next to the restaurant where we're having breakfast with a little calf.
Wow, that's cool.
You could get close enough to touch them if that were safe to do, but it is not. So definitely,
yeah, do not try to.
But it was wild. It was like
do not try
so
to
close.
Approach a moose. It's like that story. I remember, I forgot where it was. I was at, I think it might have been Yellowstone or something like that. But I asked a ranger there. This is all on a solo motorcycle trip years ago. I said, what's the dumbest thing you've ever seen a park visitor do? And he said, there was a tourist that tried to put his kid on the back of a bison so that he could take a picture.
That is amazing.
And he didn't like it. And the kid just fell off, but the guy got kicked in the chest. And he had to go to the hospital. It's
like, he's lucky that's all that happened. Wow.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, some of these large animals are amazing and they're majestic, and some of them might kind of be used to having people around, but you don't want to mess with them.
You got to take care of the wildlife. Take care of the wildlife, even just we saw a lot of cows and things like that, and you just got to leave them alone and let them do their thing.
Yeah, just show them some space and some respect. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and actually, that's a great point, Carl, is that, you know, one of our initiatives is ride respectfully, and part of that is respecting the wildlife and the livestock. And there's a lot of it out there. And it's also a threat, too. I can tell you that when we took off on the first day heading to the start of the route, I got about 2 feet from getting T-boned by a pronghorn, and it would not have been pretty. So and they come out of nowhere, and they run frantically, and they'll race next to you, and at any given time they'll just cut in front of you. So you really want to yield to all animals and keep your speed down, because it could go sideways real quick.
Wow. Yeah, another very good reminder.
Well, all right, and guys. Also, and if I can just put another fine point on that, is that is livestock as well. I don't mean to beat my drum on this, but it's super important that we go through a lot of ranch lands, and it's super important that we're respectful of the livestock that's out there. These, you know, this is these ranchers' livelihood, and we've got to respect these animals are their livelihood, and we've really, really got to slow down the yield to them. You're going to see a lot of it out there.
Yeah, it's their land too. You know what I mean?
Well, it's so public.
Yeah, no, well, but you know what I mean?
The roads, like, the roads are public.
No, but
you know,
but they spend more time there than you do, and they don't want to.
That's right.
Some of them don't. Some of them are more forgiving than others, right? Some of them don't. Any noise. Yeah. You know, anyone looking like they're showing off or, you know, destroying anything or making more ruts or anything else like that, right?
And yeah, so, we just have to remember that we're guests there. That's what we have to keep in mind.
There you go. That's an awesome way of putting it. Awesome way of putting it. All right, so burning question is, you know, when will the full movie be released? What's the best way to see it? And where can someone find out, you know, showing times and places?
So the film will premiere in California on the 5th of February. BMW and BDR are joining forces and putting on a film premiere in Murrieta, California, which is right near Temecula, if you know the area, at the Blackmore Ranch. It's going to be a really fun day. It's going to start at 4:00, where we're going to have a little expo on the ranch with some of our partners. The BMW Performance Center will be there. Rawhide will be there. The GS Trophy team will be there, and some of our sponsors as well. And then we're going to show the film at 6:00, and there'll be dinner and drinks. It's going to be a really fun event.
That's awesome.
And go to the website ridebdr.com. Go to the events page, and you can grab your tickets. And on that note, we're going to be giving away 2 tickets, right,
Carl? Yeah, that's right. That's right. So 2 free tickets.
Yeah.
And if you're not in the SoCal area or plan to make it out there, spread the word to someone who may be that might be interested. Mm-hmm. 2 free tickets to the screening. Again, that's Saturday, February 5th, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Marietta, California.
Correct.
For the first person to a direct message at RideBDR on Instagram and claim them. Okay. Mm-hmm. At RideBDR on Instagram and claim them. Excellent. Good stuff. So aside from the film launch for this, I mean, the BDR is an ongoing effort. I probably shouldn't ask the question, but I will anyway. Are there any other states that are up in the pools for possibilities for future routes?
Every